Will you win? It's your show now. So what's it gonna be? Cause people will tune in. How many train wrecks do we need to see before we lose touch? And we thought this was low. Well, it's bad getting worse. So where'd all the good people go? I've been changing channels, I don't see them on the TV show. Where'd all the good people go? We got heaps and heaps of what we saw. They got this and that with the rattle attack test and 1-2. Now what you gonna do? Bad news, misused, got too much to lose. Give me some truth, now whose side are we on? Whatever you say, turn on the boob tube. I'm in the mood to obey, so lead me astray. And by the way now, where'd all the good people go? I've been changing channels, I don't see them on the TV show. Where'd all the good people go? We got heaps and heaps of what we saw. Sitting around feeling far away. So far away, but I can feel the debris. Can you feel it? You interrupt me from a friendly conversation to tell me how great it's all gonna be. You might notice some hesitation, because it's important to you, it's not important to me. Of your horizon. Well, it's beginning to show, and all I really want to know is where all the good people go. I've been changing channels, I don't see them on the TV show. Where all the good people go? We got heaps and heaps of what we sow.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Saturday. Thank you so much for joining me this morning. For those of you who have not met me yet, my name is Jim Cunningham. I am the founder of Cunningham Legal. I so wish we could meet in person, but as we all know, many of us are still hunkered down at home. Now, some of us are working, some of us are retired, and all of us are trying to live life in this new normal. It's so unbelievable how life has changed. I just can't believe it. I went golfing yesterday with my son in the afternoon, and it was nice to just get back out and have be able to sit outside with other people and kind of feel like a human being again. But life is so, so much different. So today, the time that we have here today, what we're going to do is we're going to do some fun little polls. And a poll is a window that'll pop up on your screen. And I'll ask a question, and then you can give an answer. And what we're going to do is we're going to see what everyone's answer is. Now, we won't see the individual answer, but it'll break down by percentage on the poll. So after you click your answer, by the way, you'll want to click the little red box at the upper right-hand corner. So here we go. Here is our first poll. And the first poll is, how many of you are still in your PJs? Answer truthfully. Come on. How many of you are still in your PJs? Uh-oh. Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. Look at these polls. Is that 8 of 16, 9 of 10 of 16? Here we go. We've almost 11. We're getting ready to run out. 68%. Oh, my goodness. Well, I will say, we'll go ahead and share the poll. I will say that it did start out as most people were still in their PJs, but then it ended up the people are actually dressed. So that's a good thing. I'm dressed as well, but I was tempted just to keep my PJs on, but I thought it just really wouldn't give the best first impression, you know, especially on video. So, but weekdays are really fun because work is now, I'm spending all of my time, it seems, doing Zoom video conferences. I'm probably on Zoom 4, 5, 6 hours a day. And what's really funny is I think a lot of people who are doing video conferencing is they've got a dress shirt on top and maybe shorts and flip-flops on the bottom. And that's me, guilty as charged. So I'm shorts and flip-flops on the bottom and dress shirt on the top. So today I wanted to take just a little bit of time to converse, to connect, and above all, to caffeinate and get to know each other a little bit more. Now, as many of you know, we have continued doing business through this pandemic. I will tell you, I'm just going to be honest with you, it has not been easy. This has been a major adjustment for our staff. But since we sent everyone home March 16th, we have not let a single staff person go, which is, I'm frankly very proud of the people that work with us. They've been able to pull together and really kind of frankly limp along, but it's been really hard on a lot of different industries. And you know, we've been doing these webinars, we've been doing these video conferences. They're great, but one of the things that they are is they're also kind of impersonal. So you're looking at a video screen. And so I thought it would be fun to share a bit about myself, who I am, about the firm and our team and why I love them and the team and everyone just so much. So we have another polling question for you today. So this is our second polling question. How many of our workshops have you attended? How many of our workshops have you attended? Just one, two so far, or three or more? And whoa, lots of people, three or more. Holy smokes, wow, this is fantastic. So 12 of 19, 63 voted. Fantastic, it looks like we're done. Let's share those results. Wow, most of you have done three or more. That is, you know what? That's awesome. Thank you guys so much. I mean, I'm really glad to see that you've done three. I mean, you've done them. I mean, that's fantastic. Thank you. You know, we've been learning this whole, gosh, this Zoom platform, this working remotely. We've been learning and adapting to this new virtual world. And I want to thank you for being brave enough to learn Zoom. And that's a big thing. And Zoom just kind of arose as the big platform. In our firm, we've actually been using it for a couple of years. And that's how we stay connected with our different offices throughout California. But something funny is I turned 51, not funny, but I turned 51 in April during this whole COVID thing. And my wife organized a birthday Zoom party for me. So this is really cool. So it was my birthday. It was a surprise party. And I sat down at my computer and I saw my parents who moved to Texas about a year and a half ago from California. I saw friends from Detroit and friends from Tampa and friends from all over the place. And it was so great to meet with them virtually. But the funniest part of it is my parents who are in their sort of mid to late 70s, they're just kind of learning this whole Zoom thing. So they're on there and kind of clicking and talking to each other. They didn't realize that they were already on. And they're like, well, I can't hear them. And, you know, it was just kind of a chuckle. But even they have figured out how to use Zoom, which is fantastic. You know, most of you have had a chance to attend one of our workshops. And I'm not the only one who puts these workshops on, as you know, because you've gone to them. Other attorneys in our firm have done that, have done those. And they talk about a lot of different topics generally related to estate planning. Each attorney is based out of one of our offices in California. So we have our office in Huntington Beach, Westlake Village, Woodland Hills, Pasadena, and in the Sacramento region, Auburn and Folsom and Roseville. But if you guys have seen, we do Facebook Live. If you've seen a Facebook Live, it was really funny. There's like a cat walking across the screen. And another funny one was Jeff Rosen out of our Westlake Village office. His phone, he was doing the Facebook Live on his phone and he started running out of power. And so he's kind of walking through and we could see like the hallway in the back of his house. And then he made it to a place where he could plug in. So, you know, but one thing that I think this shows is we really kind of are going back to basics. I mean, just basic. I think the basic human need to connect, to be seen, to be heard. I know that a lot of us have been cooped up in our houses with our family, which is a blessing. But sometimes maybe it's too much of a blessing, if you know what I mean. So Anyway, I've got my cup of coffee here, and I do want to let you guys know that I like to go to this place called Chocolate Fish, which is just around the corner from my house. This is not a paid advertisement, but the nice thing about this company is they're like a lot of companies out there now where they go direct to the growers in Mexico and Costa Rica and Colombia and Ethiopia. And what they do is they make a direct connection with the individual farmer in these locations. And what they do is they essentially kind of cut out the middleman. But what I like about that is it really gives me a connection in some small way with the people in other countries who are trying to provide for their families. And because these are all, I don't know if you know how coffee production is done typically, but they're typically very small farms and families work on these. And so I think this is a really good analogy for what we do in our firm is we work obviously one-on-one with our clients. And I look in many ways at our organization as kind of like an extended family. So it's kind of like that work family. And that's very important because estate planning is all about family, right? And so that's why I like to buy coffee from these smaller producers. So it's kind of what we're doing, but with legal service. So here's what I'd like you to do. I'd like you to refill your coffee if you need to. And in a minute, we're going to play a video that my son Nick made about my life. So cool. And how Cunningham Legal came to be. Like, you know, how did we start? And Nick, my son, is 24. He's living in Los Angeles. He's a musician. And he's also helping me produce a podcast that will be released this summer. And another podcast with Connor Clemens out of our Pasadena office. So look for those. Those are going to be released this summer. Obviously, you'll be getting an email showing you where those are at. But Nick, he's a super talented young musician, and I'm super proud of him. And so here we go. Here's the video. Hi, this is Jim Cunningham, the founder of Cunningham Legal, and this is my story. I was born in San Diego, California in 1969 to a law school student and a bank teller. Soon after, my family relocated to Ventura County. Growing up, I spent a lot of time outside, riding horses with my mom and surfing with my dad. After graduating high school in 1987, I attended college at UC Santa Cruz. Go Slugs! While in school, I got the travel bug, studying abroad in places like Spain and France. As you can see, I had a blast. Soon after graduating college and starting law school, I met my wife Lori, and we were married in 1992. I was sworn into the California State Bar a couple of years later in 1994, and to my own surprise, I was a lawyer. Practicing law in the 1990s was a lot different. I had a fax machine, a beeper, and a landline. Talk about old school. In 1996, our son was born, and our lives changed forever. A few years later, in 2001, we built a home in Ventura County, and I opened the first Cunningham Legal office in Camarillo, California. Not long after, Lori and I decided to make an addition to our family, adopting our daughters Katya and Masha. I earned my private pilot's license and instrument rating in 2008, becoming the first third-generation pilot in my family and the only one never to crash a plane. Lori and I decided to move to Northern California with our family in 2008, and soon after, we opened an office in Auburn, California. In the past decade, Cunningham Legal has grown to include locations in Pasadena, Woodland Hills, and Westlake Village, with more than 25 dedicated employees. We couldn't have done it without them, but it sure is a long way from the beginning. Well, folks, so there you have it in a nutshell. What wasn't covered in that video is why I became a lawyer and why estate planning. So let me tell you a little bit. I went to undergraduate at UC Santa Cruz, and something happened to me that gave me direction and to go to law school. So I was in the dorm my first year in college, and I was a history major. I was having a particularly robust debate with another student who was in an interdisciplinary major where they're cobbling together. They're actually invent your own major kind of thing. And I said, well, you know, those interdisciplinary majors, I'm not sure you end up with a real skill set in a particular major. And it really upset the person I was talking to. And then the next day I got contacted by the dorm. I was living in the dorm, and the head of the dorm said, look, Jim, you can't criticize that major. If you do, we're kicking you out of the dorm. And I thought, man, this is not what a university is supposed to be about. We should be able to, you know, have an intellectual debate. And so of course I didn't say anything anymore. But then I realized, you know, I really think I'm going to law school because I want to know the rules of the world that I'm going to live in going forward into the future. I just don't want to be caught not knowing what the rules are. So fast forward, I graduate law school. I'm out of law school 1994, take the bar, pass it the first time. And my dad is a lawyer, and he's in his own law firm that handles car accident cases and divorce cases. And it was actually quite a large firm for the area at the time. And my dad told me, he's like, you know, these two areas of law, they're really not the best areas to practice. They're kind of stressful. I'm not sure it's a good fit for you. Well, why don't you think of something else? I was like, oh man. It's like, I was a history major, an only child growing up, liking to hang out with old people. I kind of put all that together and I thought, wow, estate planning seems like it would really, you know, I kind of found out I had a passion for estate planning. And so when I was at my dad's firm, I started working on car accident cases just at the beginning out of law school, and slowly kind of developing this estate planning practice, and started giving living trust seminars back in the day in the 90s in our firm's conference room. And my wife, Lori, was my secretary, my first employee, and the first one that I insisted that she fire. But someone else would be doing that stuff. But my mother-in-law was a fabulous cook. And so we held these evening meetings, full dinner seminars. And I still remember her chicken cordon bleu. It was all hands on deck, my in-laws, my mom, my wife. And then I started getting clients through these seminars. And by the end of the year, I hung up my own shingle in Ventura, California, just me doing my thing. And I guess you could say my dad sort of gently pushed me out of the nest, and you know, it worked out. So I'm very, very thankful for that. Through the years, we have written thousands of estate plans for thousands of clients. And along the way, I have been lucky to meet so many wonderful and interesting clients. And I thought it would be really fun to invite a special guest to have coffee with us today, so she can share some things about her experience with Cunningham Legal. Well, Michael, hello.
Hey, James, how you doing?
Bonjour.
Ah, bonjour, Jimmy.
Do you have your cup of coffee?
I do. I personally like Temple.
Oh, Temple. Yes. I love Temple. Temple Coffee. They have a store that has a penny tile store that's literally pennies. Like, they put down thousands and thousands of pennies on the whole floor and then put epoxy over it. It's fantastic. Really cool.
Well, my granddaughter craft coffee place. And it's the best.
So I want to introduce you to Michael Martin. Now, how are you doing on this stormy Saturday morning? We've got a lightning storm, I guess, coming in the afternoon. And Michael, how are you doing?
Great. It's better than 103 and 104 we've had the last couple of days, for sure, right? Yeah.
So now, you've been a client for how many years?
I don't know. Showing my age, I don't have probably 5 years.
Yeah, I was just thinking 5 years. Yeah, I think 5 years. Yeah. And so you're married, and your husband's name is Lonnie, and your name is Michael.
Yeah.
Those are interesting names.
He's got the girl's name, and I've got the boy's name.
I know. Who would have thought? So what's your background? Where did you grow up? Where have you lived? Just tell me a little bit about yourself.
Oh, gosh. Born in Colorado, but I think Lonnie and I were adding it up one time, and we've probably lived like in 40 or 50 different locations in that time.
40 or 50?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God. So you guys lived in Hong Kong for a while, didn't you?
Right. And that's where I really developed my passion, which has kind of led me through to this delightful retirement era of my life.
Nice. So what is your, what's your passion?
Art.
Ah.
Artists and in letting people kind of have their own experience with art without, you know, feeling intimidated about not knowing anything about how it was made or and I learned that in China because nobody knew me and I certainly didn't know anyone else. So gravitated towards some artists that really opened my eyes to some things and came back to America and thought, well, I'll just give it a try.
Oh, that's fantastic. And I know you do an art thing and we were talking about this, gosh, probably about a year ago. And one of the things I'd mentioned, you know, I was a history major, so I'm going to pull out a history thing. There was the Hundred Years' War in the 17th century, in the 1600s. One way that the Hundred Years' War ended was the rise of art, right? Art as a thing and museums. And so people could talk about something other than politics. They could talk about art. And that helped end this 100-year conflict in Europe, which I'm thinking, wow, it kind of sounds a little bit like today. But what was that? Tell me how that works with the art, where you do the instruction and everyone talks about what the art means to them.
I think if I'm able, anyone that knows me, it's not easy for me to tell the short story. But in the short story is that art is what is the word? It's subjective, so there's no right or wrong answer. If you look at art, there's not a right way to look at it or a wrong way, you know, and your experience with it is your own. It doesn't have to be what someone else's is. So it's an awesome opportunity for people to have an opinion about it and then use that to provide evidence. Like, why do you see that? What makes you say that? So we use it in schools, and it's really a robust way to help kids learn critical thinking, cognitive development, some self-esteem, because it isn't a teacher saying, no, that's the wrong answer. There's no right or wrong. It's a really neutral. So,
nice.
It's been a really, really great opportunity to make a difference.
So I know you and Lonnie are a blended family. And what that means is that you have kids kind of like the Brady Bunch, you know, his kids and her kids. And did that add for you like a level of complexity to the estate planning, or just tell me about the process that how you kind of felt about the whole thing?
Well, I don't know that it added a level of complexity, I guess, but we just wanted to make sure everybody was treated equally and they felt that there were no, you know, special treatment. Excuse me, Jimmy.
And so how was your experience at Cunningham Legal? I know I did your estate plan for you and Lonnie, and just tell the people who are watching here a little bit about the experience.
Well, it was a shock and awe. We had had our estate planning done, you know, probably 25 years ago. Mm-hmm. And we kind of felt comfortable, like, oh, everything's okay. We've got our will. We've got everything all sorted. But then as we got older and, you know, probably more focused on things that were going on, we realized that, wait a minute, you know, we had gotten advice that was maybe au courant at the time, but we realized that, you know, we maybe hadn't made the right decisions. So we came to you, and it was just so refreshing. First of all, as a woman, and especially in a marriage where the man was kind of the more powerful, you know, the breadwinner in this case. And I felt like you listened to my concerns. You heard me, you saw what my concerns were. You heard me, you addressed them. I felt so comfortable and safe. And you showed us things that we had never seen or known before. So we had, you know, good legal counsel those years ago with a great attorney for sure. But they're just, I don't know if it was the structure of the tax law or whatever, but we really hadn't gotten it right. So everything was addressed. And, you know, the legalese was a little complicated for me sometimes, and you'd break it down so I understood. So I left feeling heard, seen, safer than I ever felt. I mean, I really go to bed at night and I know that I've, the I's have been dotted and the T's have been crossed. And that's such a comforting thing for me at this age in my life, to know that, you know, all my loved ones are going to be taken care of and safe. And it's just a comfort. I don't know how to describe it any other way.
You know, Michael, that's so gratifying to hear, because it's a real blessing to do work that matters for people who care. And obviously you care. And this work that we do in estate planning is so important for peace of mind. And that's, I think, the number one reason that people do it is just peace of mind, is to know that stuff's set up and it's not going to be a disaster when the inevitable happens, right?
Right, right. Well, I think what was shocking is that you think that once you've done it, it's like, oh, I don't ever need to think about it again. And that, as you know, was certainly not the case.
Yeah. Well, Michael, thank you so much for coming here today. And I want to thank you for taking time out of your, I know you're so busy with all the stuff that you do. I know you're a busy person. Thank you for taking time to talk with us here today.
Gotcha. It was fun.
Well, that was fun. I just love Michael Martin. She's just an awesome, awesome client. She's an example of what I love, why I love what I do. I mean, it's just great. And you remember me saying I get to meet interesting clients? About how interesting is that? She's an art dealer, just a really interesting full life that she's lived. And we have one last polling question for you before we wrap it up. And question: what have you missed most during shelter in place? What have you missed most during shelter in place? Dining out, traveling, entertaining friends, or seeing family? Tick tock, tick tock, tick tock. So yeah, that little poll's up there. I see people are answering. It looks like, not a lot of entertaining friends. Visiting families, looking like it looks like it might be the winner there. Let's go ahead and share that. And it looks like most of you visiting with family. I got to tell you, I've missed all of that because we like to dine out a lot. We love to travel and entertain and see our family. Although for us, a lot of our kids have come back here and there, our adult children. We have 3 children, 24, and 2 girls who are 21. So, I mean, I'm working from home. I know a lot of you are working from home or at home, and living at home, working at home, being at home, it's a lot of home. And, if you know what I mean, I frankly miss going to the movies. And one thing I do that drives my wife absolutely nuts is I love to get like a big thing of popcorn and eat it at the movie and come chomp, 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 and it drives her nuts. So that and haircuts. So hopefully I'll be getting my haircut soon. But if you have any questions, go ahead and put those in the chat window. I know that we had one question from Candace. She said, hey, Jim, are you wearing flip-flops and shorts? I am wearing flip-flops and Birkenstocks. So I guess that's the legacy from Santa Cruz. So before we move on with our day and let you guys get out of here, I want to tell you about one more client we were able to help. And this is super, super important. I could tell you hundreds of interesting stories, but I did want to share something a little more personal. It's about my wife's parents. My wife's mother, my mother-in-law, passed away a couple of months ago after a very long battle with dementia and Alzheimer's. And I saw firsthand my wife, who was the primary caregiver. Now, my father-in-law is still alive, but my wife was the one in this case who was the primary caregiver. We saw it. The first thing we saw, and this was years and years ago, is my mother-in-law would pull into the driveway and open up her home and open the car door and just kind of walk in the house and leave the door open and the car running with the keys in it. And we thought, well, maybe she's forgetful. And then what really kind of scared everyone is she was pulled over at the side of the road, and we were following her home from church one day, and she was pulled over at the side of the road and not moving or just kind of creeping along. And we said, hey, what's going on? And she says, well, the car won't move. So she had kind of lost the connection of putting her foot on the gas pedal. And so that was really, really scary. And they ended up moving from Arizona back to California. We had them set up in their house with a caregiver. And then later they had to move out of their house and move into assisted living. And at one point they were paying $12,000 a month for their care for the two of them, which isn't really that bad for two people. I know it sounds like a lot of money, but it could be significantly higher. The problem is their income was about $6,000. So they had a $6,000 gap per month, and we could see that there's a burn rate and they were going to run out of money. So what we did is we set up an estate plan for them that not only let my wife and her older brother manage the finances, but also teed them up to get some very important governmental benefits from the VA. My father-in-law is a retired chief master sergeant. That's an E-9 from the United States Air Force. For those of you who have ever served in the military or know anything about that, those are the bossiest people in the entire armed forces, the E-9s. They kind of keep the military running. But we were able to do this estate plan and get some veterans benefits and get some help is the bottom line. And then unfortunately, you know, she did pass away from that, but I think she's in a much, much better place now than where she was. But that was a very difficult thing to see, you know, and I'll just say personally, I think it's one thing to be the caregiver, and that has its own issues. It's another thing to be the spouse of a caregiver, and you see how difficult it can be. And there's really not much that I could support, but it's really a difficult journey for the caregiver and frankly, the caregiver's spouse. So anyway, on a more positive note, I want to say that I certainly cannot do any of this on my own. There's a whole team of people behind Cunningham Legal. And over the past 25 years, we've developed a really fantastic team. We've got about 30 people, staff and attorneys at Cunningham Legal. They are, I will say, we are very choosy about who works at Cunningham Legal and who stays. These are caring. Number one, you have to have a big heart. You have to have a heart for service. And frankly, you have to have a heart for older people. These are caring, hardworking, smart, highly trained professionals. And they really, truly are amazing. And it's a blessing to work with them. And especially, sometimes in hard times, you see the worst come out of people. Fortunately, in this case, I've seen the best come out of people. And our staff have just really been doing a phenomenal job. And this is not easy on all the staff people. I got to tell you, you're trying to get work done. You're trying to educate your kids. You got them at home, and you might be living in a one or two bedroom apartment. It's not conducive to for some people, but for our team, they've really pulled it together, and I'm super proud of them. So before we say goodbye, I want to thank you all again for attending our workshops and for joining me today. We'll be sending you a sneak peek of the second edition of my book, okay? So this is Savvy Estate Planning, What You Need to Know Before You Hire the Right Lawyer. We're gonna be sending you a sneak peek and three chapters of the second edition. So this is an updated, there was a big change in the law and we updated this book. And I think you'll find this really interesting. And I'd also like to mail you a very special gift. So this is gonna be something physical having to do with coffee, but it's a surprise. So you're going to receive an email later today with a link. So pay attention to your email. And when that comes in, click the link. And then we'll ask you to enter some information so that you can receive this very special gift that we'll be mailing to you. And those will go out in the next week or two or so. Well, I really have enjoyed coffee with you guys this morning. I hope to meet all of you one day in the near future when things get back to some sense of normal. But until then, enjoy being in your PJs all day, if you choose. Enjoy your naps. Enjoy your Netflix. And don't forget TikTok. And bye for now.
Jimmy, there's some chat questions.
So we have some questions.
No, it's just this one guy is so curious. Yeah. He came back.